Julie Van Gorp.
And I'm Jamie Shaver. Welcome to True View. I'm Jamie Shaver.
And I'm Julie Van Gorp.
Today we're going to address a topic that is very interesting. When we have our own president telling us that the greatest threat to the future of our nation is climate change, and we have over 195 countries gathering in Paris for a climate change conference, I'm wondering, what does God really think when we have the UN Secretary General in a quote saying that the future of our planet is in our hands? Does God have an opinion on that? And what is the danger that we must be aware of and careful of as Christians?
Jamie, I couldn't be more passionate about the subject.
Watch out.
I'm concerned because I believe so many people are getting distracted by something that is not the overriding issue that is to be of concern to Christians or, frankly, to anybody. We really have no reason to fear climate change if what we are really fearing is the God who created the heavens and earth, and He is the one that is controlling not just the climate, but the earth is His. The heavens are His. He has made them. And when we put our faith in Him, we don't have to have sleepless nights. We don't have to be thinking about what are we going to do here and there.
But do I buy a green car?
That's up to you. I've got a white car. No.
Okay.
The whole aspect, Jamie, of the green gas emissions, which is what so many people think is driving the problem. First of all, many, many respected scientists have differing opinions on this. There is no clear reason to believe. There is no definitive scientific fact that says that climate change, or what used to be called at one point global warming, then it was almost concern about global cooling. We've looked at that there is nothing that would definitively say that that is something that is caused by human activity. In fact, there are many, many scientists that say it is, yes, there is an agreement that there is some warming that is going on. It is minimal over the last 100 years, but how much of that happened, you know, centuries and centuries ago, and it has nothing to do with what we call the modern way that we live. So if you want to buy a green car just to buy one, I think that's great. Where the issue comes into effect is when we are having laws and policies that are put in place in this nation and, frankly, across the globe.
I was surprised. I mean, to see 195 countries coming together on this issue, that's a big deal.
Yes. And really, if you ask a lot of people, what is behind that may well be a movement for global governments, because it is one thing to get a lot of people to rally behind, and then you have to question what is really the intent. So we have to say, when there are many scientists who differ on this and there is no concrete proof, what really is the motive behind what?
What are you suggesting is the motive?
Well, I don't know exactly what the motive is. I am not a scientist. I'm not a politician.
Okay. In your opinion, Julie Van Gorp, any thought?
I believe that it is being used as a means to bring about the globalization. And we know, according to the Bible, that one of the things that will happen in the latter days is there will be a move for one world government. I believe, frankly, that this is one of those rallying points. And it also is one that really helps with the redistribution of wealth.
Okay, hold up. In what way are they redistributing wealth through climate change?
Because the nations like the United States, like China, are the ones that where, quote, the emission problem is supposedly taking place. That is, we enact the laws to put in place, we are going to have some loss of jobs that are going to be here, but it's also our helping to fund some of the other nations that don't have the industrialization that we do. And so it's a way to bring us down and to bring them up, to make us more of an equal.
So how does that happen? So are you saying there's taxes on what on the energy we're using?
Well, there's a lot of regulations and taxes.
By
and
doing that, it's going to third world countries?
Well,
or
I just
other
know
countries?
That we're, there have been those statements, Jamie, that have been made by our president and by others that would indicate it is America's fault. We need to do things that are going to eradicate this problem, and that we have accepted that it is something that we have done that has been a detriment to other places. Now, the big issue is this. It really is for us to go back to what does God's word say about it? And we
yes, let's get there.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Because that really is the issue. And so many people are forgetting that it was God's word. God spoke, and it's so unfathomable for us to think he spoke and out of nothingness he brought forth the world. But his word over and over again says that the heavens declare his glory. He is the one that sets up the boundaries on the oceans. In fact, in Job 38, when God is talking to Job after Job has gone through all this devastation and Job has lost and been stripped of everything that he has, God's response when he talks to him is basically, you know, who are you, Job? Were you there when I brought the world into existence? And it is so much, Jamie, the presumptive sin of pride in us that thinks that we can control the world that God has brought forth, that in his word he says that he sustains. In fact, in Colossians 1, 16 through 17, I love this scripture. It says, "For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, things that were visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created and exist through him." That is, by his activity and for him. "And he himself existed and is before all things, and in him all things hold together." His is the controlling, cohesive force of the universe. So I'm not putting, there's a scripture that says, you know, I don't trust in horses and chariots. I'm not trusting in the scientists or green cars or people who are saying that we've got to take all kinds of measures. Because we know since Genesis 3, Jamie, there has been a curse that is on the earth because of the sin of man. We have all been born into that sin, and we have that sin nature. And the earth is groaning in anticipation of the return of the Lord. But God has told us in the scriptures, Romans 2 lets us know, there's a decaying process that is going on. It's just like, it's futile for me to think that I am going to, as I continue to age, that there aren't going to be some issues that develop. Yes, the earth has had some issues. Mm-hmm. We are aging, we are decaying, but it isn't something that we have to make the focus of our lives. And it's a concern, I think, for those of us who know God when we see other people taking that stance.
You mentioned the word futile, Julie. And when we come back, we're going to take a look at, is it all futility? Is it all futile to think that even just the basic recycling and some of the programs that have come about because of, as almost like a byproduct of the climate change issue, is that all futile? Is that all something that God would see and say, you know, we should or shouldn't do that? So we'll take a look at that when we come back.
Over 1 million people in the U.S. get cancer each year. Today we will be informing you about melanoma or skin cancer.
Symptoms of melanoma are changes in existing moles, the development of new pigmented or unusual looking growths on your skin, chills, cough, and feeling weak or achy.
Some risk factors of melanoma are fair skin and light colored hair, applying sunscreen, avoiding midday sun, wearing protective clothing, wearing a hat, sunglasses, and avoiding tanning beds are all ways of preventing melanoma.
Skin cancer is the most common form of cancer. In fact, 1 in 5 Americans will develop skin cancer in their lifetime. If you experience any of these symptoms, contact your doctor immediately. Yearly professional skin exams are recommended. For more information on these cancers, visit cancer.org.
Welcome back to True View. I'm Jamie Shaver, and I'm here with my co-host, Julie. And before the break, we asked the question, is it futile to actually begin implementing some of the things that we've learned about recycling and some of the other programs? Does God care if we're doing that? I mean, is that a way that we can honor God?
For sure it is, Jamie. We are to be stewards of what God has entrusted to us. God clearly gave us the earth. He created as the greatest of his creation, man. He gave us the role to be, have dominion over all creation. And part of that entails a great responsibility. So I am in no way advocating that we are irresponsible in the way we treat the earth. And when there are things that we clearly know are causing destruction, we definitely want to do our part to do that. The question is, are we making it an idol in our lives? But just to give you an example, I mean, I recycle all the time. Mm-hmm. I am that person that I'm concerned about the water usage in my house. I want to use the resources that we have. It's when we get so focused or when we have so many other issues that I believe are of such greater importance that we are having world leaders gather. If you were asking me what do the world leaders need to gather about, I would say we need to say we are in this place because we have forgotten God, and it is because we have started worshiping the creation instead of the creator.
And that's a huge danger. I mean, it is a slippery slope when you really start to look at it, because it can just start out as, I'm really concerned about this issue. This issue is important to me. I see it. I get it. I want to be a part of something. And yet, all things like that could, in fact, usurp the position of God.
And what God tells us, Jamie,
in our own lives.
For certain. Yeah. And you use that word, futility. Mm-hmm. And I find, what triggers in my mind is in Romans 1, God tells us what's very futile. In verses 18 on to 22, but starting in verse 21, because when they knew and recognized him as God, they did not honor and glorify him as God or give him thanks. But instead, they became futile and godless in their thinking. And I think that's what we see, Jamie. So many of these world rulers that are coming together, they are godless. They're not having God at all in this equation. They're not coming together to say, we need to pray.
People are the answer.
Yes.
And laws are the answer.
Exactly. We have the corner mm-hmm. on truth. Instead of going to the one who is the truth, who made the earth, who tells us he sustains us, who has told us what his plan is, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, for the earth. But he goes on and says, with vain imaginings, foolish reasoning, and stupid speculations, and their senseless minds were darkened. And I think that's a pretty good description. When we are gathering together, that's a lot of vain imaginations. We don't even know, and it's even been speculated that less than 1% of the problems could be caused by human, of these gas, green gas emissions, that less than 1%, and yet we are meeting, when we have issues. Certainly we can look at terrorism, we can look at the issues of poverty, we can look at other issues, but ultimately, Jamie, the greatest issue that I think is confronting our world is that as a world, we have forgotten God, we have forgotten his word, we have turned our back on him, and we think that we are the ones who control our destiny when God is the one who controls every one of our destiny.
And the Bible so often just speaks, and I love that God loves us enough to give us a greater picture of his plan. What is God's plan for the earth?
So interesting. Again, as I said, Jamie, it's under a curse in the sense, so we know it's going to decay, but he says in his word, heaven and earth will pass away. We know that this is temporary. Now, whether that means that there literally is going to be a whole new earth, that is open to conjecture. Because when he talks even about after the flood, he lets us know it says like a whole new world. And we know that the earth was still the earth. But we do know it is going to be transformed, or we're going to get a whole new. But just like with our bodies, when we die, we are going to get a new body. The earth is going to be new, and we're going to have a renewal of what that is. We also know that it says that there's going to be the fire that is going to come, and that will destroy us. So are some of the things that are going on where people get concerned and think, oh, we can stop this? That's the presumption, is thinking that any man can stop what God has purposed, and he is going to be bringing that new earth about.
But what do you say to the people who say, but man is ruining stuff, and therefore it is having consequences? It almost sounds like you're saying God is the only one in control. We have no control over what occurs if, say, an agency is dumping into the water, or there's something else going on that is an obvious issue and not taking care of the environment. That still does have a cause and an effect.
It does. And there again, we should be good stewards about that, but we don't need to look. When we even think about like the Valdez oil spill that happened before, was that a good thing? Absolutely not. You know, we need to make certain that we're doing everything we can to protect those things from happening. But are some of those things going to happen? Yes. But we look and say, God has created the oceans. And just like with the human body, where we look and go, okay, I may take toxins into my body, he's already gone ahead of us, and he's created our bodies to dispel that toxins. Mm-hmm. He has done that in many ways with the oil and the other toxins that are coming into our oceans. He's already got a way of dealing with that, Jamie.
Now, you had mentioned that when people, we need to be good stewards. But who sets the bar on what a good steward looks like? I mean, because some might come to you and say, you know what, I hear what you're saying, but a good steward is going to drive a green car, an electric car, and create all these laws to try to help other humans to be good stewards because they need help. But who gets to define what a good steward looks like? I mean, what does Scripture say is a good steward?
Well, I believe God's the one that defines. He's the one that gave us that term, so he's the one that defines it. I think where we run into the problem, Jamie, most of all, is it's where that idolatry. It's when we're worshiping the creation versus the creator, and looking and putting the lives of animals, for example, or the earth as equal to God's supreme creation, which is man, and man alone he created in his image. Does God care about the animals? For sure. Does he care about the land and the trees? Absolutely. But what he's also told us in his word very clearly, and it is throughout the Bible, is that the reason that the lands suffer is because of the sin. It is that we have polluted the land. And God is very clear about that. And the way we have been the worst stewards is because we've ignored God's commands. He has said that the bloodshed of the innocent pollutes the land. Violence pollutes the land. So in terms of being good stewards, the number one things we need to be good stewards on is we no longer shed the blood of the innocent, which is certainly the unborn children who are being aborted. That's one of the ways. We also do all that we can to change violence. But it's interesting, we've removed the Ten Commandments virtually out of every segment of our culture. And as we have done that, we have seen the violence increase, the bloodshed of the innocent, all those things. And the other major thing, Jamie, that took place in the land of Israel, and still is true in our time, it is when we are worshiping other idols. And that idolatry is what God says, I will reward you with your idolatry. Or when I say reward, mm-hmm. what is going to be the consequence of that is you're going to see that there is going to be a problem with the very lands. The crops are going to fail. You're going to have the water devastation and things of that nature.
When we come back, we're going to talk about additional ways that we can really be good stewards of what God's given us, and really shine his truth and his light in a world that is changing. We'll be right back.
Today we will be covering women's health, specifically two types of cancers which are common in women. The first cancer is breast cancer. 1 in 8 women will be diagnosed with breast cancer in their lifetime. Symptoms of breast cancer include lumps in the breast and swelling in the armpit, change in shape or size in the breast, dimpling or puckering of the skin, nipple discharge that starts suddenly, or new pain in one spot that doesn't go away. Gender, aging, race, genetic risk factors, family history, and previous chest radiations are all risk factors for breast cancer. Though there is no foolproof method for preventing breast cancer, getting regular physical activity, limiting your calories, and limiting your alcohol intake can all help with prevention. Women should perform a monthly self-breast exams and get annual breast exams by a doctor. The best screening tool available is a mammogram. Women age 40 and older should have a mammogram each year. If you find a lump or believe you're at risk, contact a doctor.
The other cancer we will mention is ovarian cancer. It is the leading cause of death out of all the gynecologic cancers. Symptoms of ovarian cancer are abdominal pressure, bloating, swelling, pelvic or abdominal discomfort, persistent indigestion, constipation, loss of appetite, lack of energy, and lower back pain. Age, obesity, fertility drugs, androgens, estrogen therapy, hormone therapy, and talcum powder are all risk factors for ovarian cancer. Ovarian cancer can be hereditary. If you have a family history of ovarian or breast cancer, or a personal history of breast cancer, talk to your doctor. You can prevent ovarian cancer by using oral contraceptives, gynecologic surgery, genetic counseling, and tubal ligation. Ovarian cancer is difficult to detect until you reach the later stages, making it a very dangerous cancer. If you experience any of these symptoms, contact your doctor immediately. For more information on either cancer, visit www.cancer.org.
Welcome back to TrueView. I'm Jamie Shaver, and I'm here with my co-host, Julie. We've been talking about climate change and what does that look like for a Christian. And while I definitely want to hear a little bit more about what does that look like as a Christian, I also think it's important that we remind people there is a danger here. So let's start there. What is the danger for a Christian in really getting involved in this?
The danger, Jamie, I think, again, is we so easily get distracted. I mean, one of Satan's greatest ways to get us off God's court, that path that he would have us to take, is to get us on side trails. And that, again, doesn't mean that that there aren't things that are important for us to do, but we can get caught up on the lesser priority things. And so we have some people that are making it their mission in life, for example, to be involved in climate change. Well, God's given us a mission. Our mission is to serve God and to know him and to make him known, to go and tell other people. And some of the concerns...
Go and tell other people what, though? Because some of them might be saying, but I am serving God by telling them to be good stewards, and therefore I'm telling them about God.
That is what I would say fallacious reasoning, in the sense that find me in the Word of God where he says, this is your mission, is to go and save the earth. That is nowhere. What he does tell us to do, and it's very clear in Matthew 28 is one of the main verses, you know, go ye therefore into all the world, and that we are to make disciples in his name. So what are we to tell them about? It isn't to tell them, oh, go and make sure that you're recycling and make sure you're going green and make sure you're doing this. No, we are to help them to know that there is something that can change your soul. They are soul sick, and they need to know there is a great physician to be found in Jesus, who is there, who can take that pollution that is the sin in their heart, mm-hmm. and he can recycle it, and he can make their life new. That is the major thing, Jamie, that we need to be talking about.
When people are talking about that and making God the center of everything, is climate change or any of the recycling any part of that message?
I don't see it as, again, definitely feel that we should do our duty as stewards and do that which, as you pray to the Holy Spirit and the Lord puts on your heart, if you're to go get a green car, go for it. I don't see there being anything wrong. It's when you elevate that message to be greater than the message God has given us to make.
Well, and I see a great example of that when you're saying elevating that message is when often you will see, or at least hear in the news, about an activist of some kind that has decided, like you said, to make their mission, I don't know, to save a particular animal or a particular waterway, and they actually take the lives of humans or injure human beings. for this cause. And to me, Julie, it's such an example of when Scripture says that sin begets sin, and you have one sin that leads to another and leads to another. The first sin there is that they are putting their love for the earth or for that animal or for this
right.
idea ahead of God and in front of God. And therefore, because that's out of balance and out
yeah.
of order, then you end up seeing these catastrophes and really senseless tragedy of human beings, and if not even human beings, their livelihoods can be stripped.
For sure.
Over and entire populations, as I know we saw in California this year, who are then put in a place where the very resources that God had given them as a blessing, that they need to live, like water,
correct.
Is being completely diverted and just dumped into the ocean over some, what I would call, fanatics who think that this is more important than human beings getting the water that they need to live.
I couldn't agree with you more.
Or the crops that they need.
And we
to
had
eat.
The same thing in my home state of Georgia, where because of some mussel that was down in Florida, we were having to make sure that our water, our lakes and all that, that we were having them a certain way. Well, that was affecting the people, the livelihoods of people, and again, to be able to enjoy the blessings God has entrusted. Or another example, Jamie, is, you know, when that person is throwing eggs or, you know, other kinds of excrements and things on women who are wearing mink coats. It's like, are you respecting more that animal that's already been killed? I don't quite get that. But going against that person. If you have that as an issue, there are ways you can deal with those things respectfully. But I go back, Jamie, I think the most important thing we have to understand is that where does God ask us to put our priorities? It is in living in accordance with His commands. The reality is this, our nation, when we were truly a nation that was living under God, was blessed abundantly. The resources that we have are plentiful. And so much of even the regulations that are being imposed right now, we still have the resources, but God is allowing a lot of those things to take place, I believe, because we are a nation that in so many ways has forgotten God. We have kicked Him out, and He will allow us to experience the consequences of our sin so that we will come back and cry out for mercy, just as He did in the days of Israel. But their land suffered because of the idolatry. In fact, it says...
But couldn't you be... the idolatry could be money. You idolatry, you know, you have an idol of money in your heart, and therefore, to save money, it's cheaper to just dump all your sewage into the nearby river.
Well,
I mean, you would say
certainly.
that absolutely is still a sin, and that's
Without
also
a
it's
doubt.
A different type of idol.
Yes.
But it's still also leading to a bad decision.
Correct. It's again... Only God knows what the heart intent is. Mm-hmm. We are to respect what He has given to us. We're to respect other people even above the earth that He has given to us. And we are to respect Him above all and abide by His commands. And one of the things, Jamie, that I think is just so important for us to recognize, though, is the last time that we look and say, in Scripture, God sent a flood that wiped out the world. But He gave also the covenant. He would never do that again. And in Genesis 8, I think this really sums up God's word on climate change. I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from the youth. Neither will I ever strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, and again, He's the only one that controls that. We can't choose that the earth is going to be here or go away. Seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. What an awesome promise we have from our God who always keeps His word. And He's the one who really knows all the facts, Jamie.
And He's the one ultimately in control of climate change. So we thank you so much for watching this show. Please join us on our Facebook page as well as check us out on our website at trueviewministries.org.